meals on other days, but when it was a free day, then we would they would eat their rice, and then they would come to our place, and we would have a long program, and I mean the long one. They never seemed to get tired. We varied it in many ways. We had choirs. We had the school children put on Christian playlets, you know, and we always had three or four preachers who preached maybe 10 minutes each. Anyway, that this would go on, say, from 10:30 till 1. And then we let them all out, and the church people, the young people, would have been cooking all night the night before. And we'd give them a good meal at about 2 or 2:30. And then they'd make their long trip back to, as I say, 5-7 miles, many of them. And we really got them in. And then, of course, Marion was always in the house, and everybody who came to these big affairs would come and timidly knock on the door and say, "Can we see your house?" And over there, the men and women don't sleep together. The woman sleeps separately with the small children, you know, and the man sleeps in the front room. So they were always interested in the fact that we slept together in the same bed. And then we also had a little cubby hole for each one of our children, just 6 by 9, but nevertheless it was their own room, you know. And all of these ideas, they were interested in seeing. And we had a rug on the floor like this, and we had Western furniture, but when these people came, we moved the Western furniture back, and we had them all sit on the floor where they were more comfortable. And Marion would serve them bitter tea and jandiga, which is raw sugar, raw brown sugar squares. And this was the way we had to win their confidence. See, bear in mind that when we went there, there were only two old churches with about 170 members, so that we really had to win our way. Well, I walked thousands of miles, because there were no other ways to get to many of these villages. Oh, you could drive a few miles with a jeep, but there was there were just dirt roads, and when they got wet, they were just almost impossible even for a jeep. So I walked from village to village to village. Fortunately, before very long, we began training the bow themselves. We picked out choice young fellows and sent them down to Rangoon, where we had a theological seminary, and they would stay there 3 years maybe and then come back. And so before long, I had a lot of companions to travel with me on these trips, you know. I didn't do as much preaching, so I let them do the preaching. Usually when we were walking or getting there, they would ask me about things. And then periodically, I did a lot of short courses, bringing in laymen and pastors from a certain area for a 10-day period, you know. And we fed them and housed them, and I would go through a series of courses like Bible and theology. And one of the things they needed very badly was questions and answers. When we have these problems, how do we deal with them? This sort of thing, you know. And I also always had one on the rural pastor, because I wanted them, all these people, to know that the rural pastor and the people themselves could make a better living if they just accepted some basic ideas about rural life, you know. Pigs, well, pigs and chickens, we made them pay for them. We never gave them anything, but they would come. Quite honestly, the pigs that we had got the best reputation in all of Burma. I used to haul them by plane to these distant places. And it got to the place at the end where the Po'os, I had a good farm manager who took care of pigs and chickens and a lot of the other things around there. And he would let them know when this particularly handsome sow was going to farrow, you know. And these peeps would come and lean over the fence while the sow was farrowing and say, "Now, I want that one, I want that one." And fortunately, I got a good line of pigs. And
did they interbreed them with their own pigs?
Yeah.
What, you didn't send out breeding pairs then?
Yes, we sent out piglings. But usually we sent out, we got rid of the piglings in pairs in order that they could set up a supply, you see. I mean, when you start out with only two, that doesn't get very far. So you need to build up a good breed for a while, and then you begin the crossing work.
Sure.
But the ones I had were already crossed. I found that they were tougher breed if they were crossed than the pure American breeds. Or I had Japanese breeds, I had Australian breeds, and American breeds, and they were tougher if they were crossbred. And if you did it right, and I'm not a geneticist, but I learned from the books how selective you can be. You know, I wasn't always right, but I was right most of the time. Anyway, this was true of both pigs and chickens.
We always think of Brake Cakes as a pig man.
Right. Well,
his work pretty much died out because of the war by the time you were doing this.
Well, you know, he was trying to get it reestablished, and he was drowned.
I know.
Crossing one, a storm blew up on one of the lakes, and he was loaded with gear, and the boat turned over, and he was drowned. Well, I'm very proud of the fact that many of them called me the second Bull Case. Bull means leader, and Case, they don't even say S, they say Bull Case. But they called me Dutia Bull Case, which means the second Bull Case, because I did the same kind of thing I did. You know, he was known for carrying a pig around under his arm and saying, "This is a Christian pig, and I want you to do something about it." And he always, whenever he traveled, he had a whole coop full of, a bamboo coop full of chickens, too. He was known for that, and he did the same thing. He was in an area where vegetables were already fairly good, so he worked mostly on soybeans and good varieties of rice and all that, field crops, in other words. He was more a farmer than I was. I was a market gardener sort of thing. His work was, some of the men he trained were still there, and of course I made my connections with some of them and continued the work that he had done. But of course I was opening up a whole new area that he'd never visited before.
He was in northern Burma.
No, he was in central Burma.
Oh, central.
And I was in east central, but there's a big mountain range there that we don't get over too easily. I mean, he didn't come up into our area very much. Burma's a big place, you know. It's large as the state of Texas.
I guess I didn't know it was that big.
The largest country in Southeast Asia is Burma. And so to expect one man like Case, even as much energy as Case had, he couldn't cover it. I keep talking about all these various things that we did, and later the idea of having Christian centers spread all over Burma. People came and saw what I was doing, and they modified it to some degree to meet their particular needs, you know. But there were at least six of them when I left in 66. This center-type work where you would tackle two or three problems of man at the same institution. You know, here in the United States, we separate them all out. But that isn't so effective as when you can pull the three together. Of course, the whole purpose of it, and I realize I've been talking a lot about things that we did The whole purpose was to win those people so we could preach to them. They wouldn't come in unless we knew how to win them first to ourselves before we could preach them. And, I did just about...
You don't think you were preaching to them by giving them better animals and better food?
Well, oh yes, I was. But that is only one aspect of it. In other words, the chapel on the hill or the tabernacle on the hill was as important as the three others. But you couldn't get them to come there until you convinced them that you were their friend. And so I did a lot of that kind of thing. I slept in their houses. I ate their food. I got bitten by their bed bugs, came home with their lice. All of these things were that I could break down the barriers. And a lot of the time I wore their clothing. Especially when I was in the house and relaxing. Sometimes I would wear Western clothing for driving the Jeep and hiking. But when I got in the house, I would take off my trousers and put on a longi or a pair of big trousers, which many of them wear there, big enough for three people, but they're real baggy, you know. But it does mean you can sit on the floor cross-legged and be comfortable, which you can't be in these things.
I can't anyway.
And all of these things, eating their food, staying in their houses, speaking their language, wearing their clothes, all of them were, shall we say, breakers.
How did you approach the problems of the lice and the fleas and all that kind of thing? Did you...
I tolerated them till I got back. To the house, and my wife would say, "Now, don't bring all that stuff in here. You're going to have to put that out in the sun for a while." And the lice, why, I had to wash my hair in kerosene quite often. Later, I began to find certain things in the market in Rangoon, where I went shopping. It was 450 miles away, but I went down to do my shopping. I found various kinds of protecting things like, gamaxane, which is something powder you put around in the corners, and it will keep lice down, fleas down for and bed bugs down for at least 3 months. And I began packaging it. I bought big drums of it back from Rangoon and took it out and packaged it in small packages of 8 ounces and sold it to the people for, you know, buying it in big quantities. I could sell it to them for a very cheap price. And after a while, some of their houses were free of these things because I taught them how to use it, you know. Another way of just improving their health a little bit, because there were bed bugs and lice and ticks, all of these things, very, very, very many of them in that country. And any way to keep that down, and we try to sell them the idea of mosquito nets and that kind of thing. You know, when you go into a new group of people who have had so few opportunities to pick these kind of things up, the missionary becomes almost the total expert on everything in that area. And I just felt, well, anything I could do to improve their life was going to win them to me, and also it strengthened the few churches we had, and churches began to grow rapidly. I was there for approximately 20 years, and they increased from 2 to 17. Now, that doesn't sound like an awful lot, but when you're speaking to Buddhists who are strong Buddhists, they're one of the strongest Buddhist groups, it's not easy to win them. But we did have this growth. And what's even more exciting is that since we have left, in that one area, I had two fields. One was the center where I was, and then 125 miles north was another center with a different language and all the rest of it. In the northern center, we have increased the number, since I left, we have increased the number from 17 to 43, which I consider very good in the Buddhist country.
How many members?
Well, something around 5,000 members.
That's great.
And this has been going on. The greater growth has been since we left. This is what makes me feel good. We apparently laid a good foundation, and we also, with all this travel that I did, we were able to instill into all of our pastors and evangelists that you don't wait for them to come to your church. You go out to preach to them in their own localities. And as a result, toward the end, I was the only white person in the area, but I can say quite honestly, nearly everybody in this big area of 12,000 square miles knew who I was.
When you speak in our churches here in this country, do you ever happen to mention to the pastors that it's good to go out to the people instead of waiting for
them? Oh, very often. I use this. I say, too many American churches put the signboard in the front of the church saying our meetings are at 9:30 Sunday school, 10:30 or 11 o'clock worship service, and midweek service 7 o'clock on Wednesday. And we expect people to come in just from reading the sign. I said they don't.
I want to back up just a little bit. You talked about these people being Buddhist. I had thought that most of the Korans were, of all kinds, were animistic rather than Buddhist.
Well, it's very interesting. This particular group was in the Thaton state. And Thaton, which is down on the coast, was the first place that Buddhism came into Burma. And so these Po'os were slaves of the king of the Thaton. So all of them were forced to go through the Buddhist training, and they became Buddhists that way. Now, they still have an underlying animistic beliefs, too. But later on, I made it intense while I was at Cornell. I did my animism at Hartford. When I got to Cornell, there was a man who was a Buddhist teaching. And he and I kind of sat at either end of the log, you know, and talked about Buddhism. So, and I wrote at least a half a dozen 30-page papers for him. And the best grades I ever got in my life were from that man.
Mm-hmm. Did you finish your PhD studies?
I came back after they assigned me to study the Po'o people. After a little bit of argument, they said, and then I said, well, I can't get back here in the 5 years that you allow for a PhD to complete it. And they said, well, that doesn't make any difference. We'll extend that to 8 years. So I was out on the field for 6.5 years from 45 to 52. And then I went back to Cornell. I didn't mention that, but we went back to Cornell. And by that time, Marion was doing translation work. The Poles didn't have any they had a written language, but it was very ancient, and practically nobody in the modern day could write it. It was so complicated. So she and I worked together to put the Po'o language in a new orthography and new spelling, because we wanted to put out the Bibles and hymn books, you know. I mean, the scriptures and hymn books.
What, did you use just a basic phonetic alphabet, or did
no,
you?
No, we use Burmese script.
Oh, really?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, both of us didn't like the idea of introducing Western stuff. Now, improving pigs and chickens, that's not necessarily Western, but when you get to writing, you've got a Western alphabet, and they were completely unfamiliar with that. As a result, we adapted the Burmese script. We had to add about a dozen new forms, ABCs, you know,
yeah.
So that we had a total of about 39 alphabetical forms, and we did it in that. So Marion began that shortly after she arrived. As a matter of fact, we put out a Gospel of John. She arrived there in 47, and we had to do all this basic work of changing the orthography. We had to learn the language, and there was no one who could speak enough English, so we learned the language by the hard way, and no books to teach us how to learn. And by 1950, she had put out the Gospel According to John. And we distributed them in little booklets, just John itself. Some people say, well, why did you begin with John? Well, some of the great concepts in the Bible are there, you know, in the beginning. The Good Shepherd, the prayer that Jesus made for his disciples in John 17. A lot of good stuff in John, and we thought that probably this was as good as any. And you didn't have to have too much knowledge, as you do for Matthew and Mark, of the Hebrew, you see. I mean, the forebears of the Christians. And we were starting with a new bunch. So why shouldn't we give them the most easily assimilated material? But before long, we were doing everything. She never did quite finish it, but for 16 years she worked at translation work. I'll say the American Baptist Foreign Missions Society got a bonus.
Bad heart? No bad heart.
No bad heart. And the interesting thing now, and the most wonderful thing for me, when my wife died just over a year ago, I said to people, don't send flowers. I said, send a memorial, contribute to a memorial fund for Marion. And we're still getting gifts. The word gets around slowly, and people make their mind slowly. But that memorial fund is over $16,000.
Oh, that's great.
And we are using it, we'll be using it, as soon as things straighten out a little bit in Burma, to republish the New Testament, which she translated. And that's another thing that keeps going on. You know, when you ask me, well, what are the things you really feel good about? That's one I feel very good about. Another one is that Bible school we founded 34 years ago.
This?
Yeah.
We'll see what we can do here. Well, right now I'm looking at the wrong thing, but we'll look at this first.
Too close?
Right now we're on here. What's this building?
Well, that's one of our churches and its congregation. Most of the village churches have only 75 to 125 people in them. That was one that was there when I arrived in 47. Not the building, but the church. That's a new building. And actually, the pastor of that church was ordained at the same time as I was.
Oh. You mean the present pastor or the pastor?
No, the pastor at that time. He's now dead and gone.
Now you say this is the Bible school?
Yeah. That's not quite true. The idea was the idea of Erbil Sowards, who was our field secretary at that time. But since I was there, guess who did all the work on the thing? And it's been a very successful venture. We were having problems with sending our hill people down to the plains. For one thing, they didn't like the rice down there. The hill rice and the plains rice, very different. Another thing is they got ill too often. And the third thing is there were no people of their own group to do field work on weekends, you know. So Erbil had the idea, and I backed him strongly in it. And he, of course, had to work on getting the money. That was the big thing. That's been going now 34 years, and we have young fellows and girls from 12 different tribes who study together there, all over that area.
12 different tribes, not all different kinds of Karens. They're all...
No, other tribes. Shans, Burmese, Karens, Lisus, all of them come in there. They love it. They love it. And we sometimes have to give them some training in Burmese, because their Burmese isn't good, but to teach all 12 tribes, we have to use a common language, of course. And so Burmese is the common language. And most of them have to do a little bit of extra work to get their Burmese. But then they study in Burmese. But at the same time, alongside of all of these tribes that we are serving, have their own, at least, New Testaments. And as a result, they can look at the Burmese New Testament and their own New Testament, and as they study, you know, and are able to assimilate the material. And then they go back to their own people.
Who did the tapestry?
Oh, this was given... A woman did it.
Is it woven or painted?
No, it's woven. It's really beautiful stuff. I don't know how long a woman worked at it, but she worked a long time.
The bricks fascinate me.
The bricks are cement block. Cement block.
That you made yourselves.
It's easy to make, and takes just a little bit of cement, a little bit of lime, and mostly sand.
And do you jiggle?
Yes, you jiggle them and then pack them into a mold, and then you leave them out in the air, and the sun and the rain cures them, so they get really very strong. And it's a bigger school than that now. They've got two or three outer buildings because last year the school had to be closed because of the Burmese, the upset in the Burmese government, you know. But they're open again now, and they have 70 students. And you know, the thing about a school like this, which I tell many people whom I talk with, the cost of running this for a full year, and this means food for the students and paying the teachers. We have some teachers who come and teach one course voluntarily, but they have a staff of six and 70 students. And I figured it out in 1987, where there was the last full year we had. It only cost $26,000 for the 9 months that those kids were in school. The whole works.
How many students did you see?
70.
70 students.
Not cost that much for one.
Just makes you, I keep talking about this to people because Your dollar goes so far over there. Now, they don't live very high on the hog. Not much meat in what they eat. It's rice with curried vegetables and